You're welcome back to The Breakfast on Pulse TV Africa. 3 days ago, former Vice President Atiku Abubakar posted a thread of 27 tweets. He was talking about the need for Nigerians to identify as Nigerians and not just as a northerner, southerner, Igbo, Hausa, Yoruba, or any other tribe or religion. He started with the words, Nigeria is drifting. And somewhere in between, he preferred a solution. That's a summit of national unity convened by governors. Our media consultant and Atiku's 2019 presidential campaign spokesman, Segun Shoumi, is joining us on the show this morning. Good morning, Mr. Shoumi.
Good morning, Plus TV. How are you guys doing?
Well, good. Good to have you as well.
Okay.
All right. So we know that former Vice President Atiku Abubakar has been speaking about national issues. But this time around, I want you to just hit straight to the heart of the matter and tell us what exactly is the key message Atiku is trying to put out there.
Well, I guess, Yuma, I mean, it's self-explanatory from that release. Patriots must, from time to time, respond to what they see as probably present danger in the system. You cannot really love this country at its level and be seeing all of the country going in their separate ways without offering something that looks like a suggestion or probably an admonition or even a way out. Mm-hmm. And what Atiku Abubakar has done is to say that, look, Nigerians, all of the things that we see is no reason for us to break up our country or to revert back to our ethnic lines or our tribal positions. He started by saying that, oh, as far as he's concerned, all he knows is his tribe is Nigeria. Then he went a step further by saying, look, it seems to be that the conversation around the country's national conference, let's chat, let's have a way to know what we want to do. And then he said to the governors, you don't have to throw in the towel just yet. All of you as a bunch of leaders managing the country at sub-national level, which are states divided into 36 and plus Abuja, you can come together. You don't have to wait for just one person at the presidential villa or a president, whoever the president may be. In this case, it's President Buhari. Why don't you all come together and have this dialogue among yourselves, raise the kinds of stakeholders you all need, and promote and have this national conversation for national unity, driven not by the villa in Abuja, but driven by the middle level authority, which are the governors. So I think it's his own contribution to say, I'm not keeping quiet. I'm not just looking and, you know, taking any political capital from the crisis in the country. I'm indeed demonstrating that every leader who is a statesman must constantly put in ideas that can unite us and get us moving. So that's what the idea is.
All right. There's been some criticism towards Atiku Abubakar. If you see, if you look through the, you know, most of the responses to that tweet or that thread, there's people who have mentioned that he was silent at certain times and, you know, asking why he suddenly has found his voice now that southern governors decided to meet. And at other times when other northern governors had, you know, come together, you know, he didn't, you know, have these ideas. Also, criticism for him not speaking out, you know, when there was, you know, conversations concerning the Minister of Communications and Digital Economy, Issa Pantami. So how would you respond to that?
Well, first, let's just say that we welcome the comments and the engagement. When you make a statement at that level, you want it to be engaged. If it is not engaged, it means nobody even read it. Mm. When they are engaging it, you take time to listen to what they're saying. Some of them, you say, okay, I can agree with this, I will improve on it. And some of them, you know, it's just mischief. In this particular instance, I need to state and state it very clearly. Nobody of Atiku stature can ever be reduced to a talking parrot. It's not his responsibility to speak on every issue and all issues and go jump into every fray or even speak in a way that makes the situation worse.
Yeah.
Some issues require other people to talk about. Some issues require he speaks about. And you must be fair to him. Whatever you will say about Atiku, he has consistently acted like a statesman, bringing in ideas, communicating on issues, calling people to issues that require all of us to take pay attention to, and it's very busy trend. Now, if people say, why is he not talking when northern governors are talking? Sometimes we wonder, when you state the too obvious, are you not just playing to the gallery? sometimes when the northern governors speak, the issues are already being engaged and there isn't any real red flag. But when you have a situation where southern governors for the first time come together, not minding the party lines, in one location, you can see that the amalgamation of North and Southern Protectorate is already up for conversation. When you add on top of that all of the ethnic jingoists and champions who are pulling from different sectors, then you know that, we need to say something. And the vice president, the former vice president, and our presidential candidate are spoken. I think people should try to limit themselves to what he has said. Asking him to speak all the time, asking him to talk on Patani, asking him to speak even when somebody's dog is not eating well, asking him to speak when their wives don't get pregnant is unfair to someone who speaks all the time. And when you look at the Twitter generation, I dare tell you that you engage them and you watch the way they behave and all of that, you kind of like get the impression that we've lost it at some point in time in terms of national orientation. Why? They're angry with everybody. They're angry at everything. There's nobody that is spared. They have no restraint. It's okay, let's just leave the messenger for a second and take a look at the message. And it does not indicate that we're developing progressively. Of course, there's a lot of energy for young people, and that energy must come out. But I think that when leaders are saying, don't let us destroy the country, we must be happy to say, okay, we've heard this. And you know, you never even know. Some of these things are trolls. Some of these things are sponsored. Some of these things are political, you know, issues. But I always say, and I say all the time, when you are a public figure of the nature of Atiku, you must be ready to accept some animadversion. Animadversion means a natural level of criticism that comes with being in public space. And so in that breath, okay, we take it. Atiku understands. He has taken some of their comments. He will speak some more. When some more issues come up, he will talk about it. But this particular one, he has said it in the absolute interest of national unity. All right. Young child will not know the potential of a crisis before it comes. Experience makes an elderly man know that what an elderly man can see seated, sometimes children cannot even see it if they are climbing on the tallest mountain.
All right, I'll quickly also just ask if you can quickly share on this one. Is his ideas of governors all coming together, across the 36 states, regardless of party lines and religious leanings, does that in any way mean taking away the responsibility from the president? Or does it mean accepting that the president at this time may not be capable of really putting Nigeria in the right direction?
I think that it's consistent with our own idea of devolution of authority and power and responsibility. We cannot always insist that the one office of the one president, however important and powerful, is where all ideas must come from, is where all solutions must come from. He was trying to say that, look, we've seen what the southern leaders have done. They've come together to have a conversation. Why don't you stretch it a little further? Pull yourself together. You have a very wonderful platform called the Nigerian Governors Forum. Lock yourself in. Agree the modalities to ensure that more Nigerians can participate in the conversation and drive it. Why must change or substantial issues of this nature, why must it come from just the president? And I'm not sure that at this time I would say he's saying the president does not. No, that's not it. There's time for politics and there's time for national building. What he was talking about and what he was trying to say is that, gentlemen, governors, don't feel so helpless. You are the ones that are in charge of your environment. You know your stakeholders. If you want to have a conference to discuss and engage, why not do it together? Shouldn't we champion some one Nigeria? Everybody in the country is not going to be a secessionist. And definitely, Atiku will never subscribe to an idea of a country that is as magnificent and as glorious as Nigeria breaking up.
So I'm glad that earlier in your message, you mentioned that, you welcome criticism and that that's important as well, when you take that. Because some of the comments we've seen, in response to this message has been poking at the motive behind what Atiku said. So could you clarify what, might have driven Atiku to post that message on Twitter?
It's the same thing that made Atiku speak when COVID was coming. Before COVID hit the country, Atiku was the first person to start saying, Let's close the airport. Let's close the airport. There's no motive there. When we started, when COVID finally landed, Atiku was the first person to say, let's gather together and raise some money in the private sector. That's who he is. It's unfortunate. Sometimes I wish he was not a politician, but alas, he is. So when he speaks, there is always that tendency to think that there's a political capital or political opportunity to take from it. But you must measure the language that Atiku picks. Any politician who wants to take value from the crisis now will not be speaking unity. That person will probably be pumping the same hate and probably be blaming the president and probably be saying, that's not what Atiku is saying. So leave politics aside. Some leaders still believe that this country is worth salvaging.
So if you say there's no political motive, can you confirm to me that Atiku has no plan to run for presidency in 2023?
I don't understand how whether Atiku will run for president or Atiku will not run for president. I don't know what got to do with speaking to national issues at this time. And on that question of Atiku running for president, let me put it this way. Atiku is not the type of leader who doesn't research, listen subtly to what is going on in the country, examine his own soul to be sure that he can, you know, put it together and contribute. And all of these things that will come and help Atiku to take a decision on running or not running, he would take that decision in his own time. No one should say that there's a gag on Atiku just because he ran for election in the past. We know people in this country who just overhit the policy when things don't go their way. We are members of this country, when people are saying baboon and all of that will be dipped in blood, you have never, I repeat, never found Atiku once say anything that is indecorous about this country. And if this generation cannot say, okay, we see a good man here, perhaps the future generation and historian will take a look at all things and say, okay, that was a Democrat. He really meant well for his country.
All right. Quickly speak also on his views concerning restructuring. How much belief does he have in the fact that Nigeria needs to be restructured? And, you know, explain also, if you can, what type of restructuring he might be leaning towards.
I think that, first of all, you have to know that Atiku comes from the Northeast. Sometimes we're quick to lump the North together as though there are no underpinning issues that bother on restructuring even in the North. You cannot say to me that people of Benue, who you call North Central, will be happy with a process that doesn't give them enough opportunity to show themselves as egalitarian. Ditto the people in Southern Kaduna and all that. So let's go easy on lumping everybody that has a Muslim name from the North as being comfortable with this arrangement. That said, Atiku believes that for you to have a great federation, especially now that you have a lot of young people in the population in bubbling and so much energy, Atiku believe you are not allowing it to grow well if you stifle it by insisting that you want to take all the power in the center. And Atiku believes that the powers that we put in the center are way too much. They're not, the person who's sitting there is not even able to do it. There's no jack of all trade. And Atiku believes that we can begin to devolve power to the constituent part so that those parts can feel unhinged. One of the areas where Atiku is very strong on is that Atiku has never been able to understand why we're not able to have multimodal, multi-layer policing. Policing that it allows the states to have police, local government, and all of that. And don't forget that Atiku came from a system and a generation where they knew how local government worked. And in their own time, some of them were even sent on, you know, scholarship by local government. So they have seen a system that worked. This is a generation that saw the Civil War. This is a generation that saw all of our premiers. And this is a generation that has also seen the military system and the unitary system and the flawed federalism we're running now. And before anybody would tell me that, oh, why didn't Atiku do it when he was vice president? Hello, the kind of country we run, the difference between the president and the vice president is like the difference between heaven and earth. Unless the president keys into an agenda, sometimes it's difficult for any other person to push it. The vice president truly is a spare tire. Some responsibility is created, but please do not hold Atiku fully responsible for what vice presidents can do. After all, Oshibadi, who is the son of the Awolowo family, is in the villa now. How come he's not been able to influence them to do a national conference? It is the limitation of the kind of structure we want. So Atiku believes in restructuring. He has always believed in restructuring. He's written a lot of books on restructuring. He's championed restructuring. He's been consistent with restructuring. And I do not know if he decides he wants to run, if Nigeria is given an opportunity, you'll be sure that Atiku will restructure almost immediately.
Okay, so we understand, you know, this restructuring cause. And one of the tweets here from Atiku reads, I call on Nigerian governors to stop waiting on Abuja to make changes and instead convene a national unity summit of all Nigerian governors to iron out the thorny issues affecting the destiny of our nation and figure out a way to resolve them. You know, that's basically what he's saying. So I think one of the important questions here is who will bail the cat? Which governor do you think right now will stand up to begin to make these conversations and lead them?
Well, they have a very, they have a strong structure that works. They have a governor's forum. There's a chairman of governor's forum. They have a southern governor's forum. They have chairman of this, the constituent, six geopolitical zone governor's forum. Are you getting what I'm trying to say? Mm-hmm. They have a secretariat for the Nigerian governor's forum. They have more than enough capacity, ability. All that is required is the political will. And are you telling me that you can't have a meeting of governors in Nigeria? If you can have them go to each other's wedding ceremony, attend things to their children, you can have them meet at Jack, you can have them meet on other issues, why can't they meet on an issue that seems to be very loud in the line, in the hearts of their people? There's hardly any section of the country that is not talking about this matter. Some of them are for it, some of them are not for it. We have tilted it to a level where quite a lot of noise is coming on successionist. That means people are even actually asking to leave the country, to leave the union. You can't have all of that and then not say to them, oh, gentlemen, yes, we could wait for Abuja all we want, but in the meantime, while Abuja is making up his mind, why don't you governors take the lead?
So,
you just mentioned key stakeholders. You know, when I asked who will bail the cat, and you said political will is a challenge. But, I mean, the Minister of State for Petroleum just yesterday said categorically that the government does not lack political will. So if the government does not lack political will, you mentioned people to do it. Like, so when should we be expecting this National Unity Conference or summit?
The Minister of State for Petroleum, you need to know how that works. Those are appendages of the presidency. They can sit down there and wait for their leader to give them the nod. Governors, if only they know their powers, are separate, respected, independent entities leading their own states. Therefore, if the governors' forum platform will be used to convey a meeting of governors, and I can imagine them now agreeing the framework, what can be discussed, what cannot be discussed. I can imagine them now saying how many representatives will come from each of the states or how many are they want to pick it up. And I can imagine them saying, okay, we'll have that meeting maybe in Lokoja. Just say, okay, Yaya Bello, this is where Lokoja is. We used to be a capital here. It's one of our ancient capital. It's the conference state. Yaya, if you can be chairman of the committee to do the validation, you might as well provide us with an opportunity to have you there. And if they don't want Lokoja, they can go to Calabar. If they don't want Calabar, they can go anywhere in the country. The Nigerian landmass, we know where our borders are. We can pick Abuja. We can pick Lagos. If you come to Ogun, I'm sure my governor too will be willing to do it. There is more than enough space for us to have this dialogue. We are not in want of a space. What we need, or what Atiku is suggesting, is you guys as governors take the lead, take the charge, convert this conversation. First, have it among yourselves, and then set up a framework to have it. Even if the presidency was to convene a conference now. The presidency is not the only one that's going to generate the list of all the people that will be there. Some of these things have to come from governors. Some of these things have to come from all of these, ethnic groups, Afeni-Feri, IPOB, blah, blah. And all of these people are not invisible to governors. That's what he's saying.
All right. What would you say are some of the factors that might make this convergence difficult or, you know, has stalled it from happening for a long time? And how can we defeat some of these factors? Because, you know, there is obviously, I believe, some governors who may not be interested in this, you know, uniting of the Nigerian Governors Forum. So is that maybe one of the factors? And also, how effective will they be in able to implement the resolutions that they come up with as a Nigerian Governors Forum?
Okay, very good. One thing, first is first. When we encourage governors to take the lead, we're actually devolving power and responsibility to them, even if they can think properly. The second thing you need to understand is that I doubt if there's any governor who will say he's not aware of what the issues in the country is. Why has it been difficult for the people at the presidency, the previous one, and even this one to do it? Because it's about removing power from the president. Now, you're not going to excitingly be willing to sit on a conference and say, oh, take some of my powers. The people we're hoping will take that power are the governors, because we're not going to restructure until we restructure into our individual houses or in our individual opinions. No, we're going to be restructuring in a manner that devolves more power, more responsibility to governors. Let us hope that if that finally happens, a whole lot of them will be more responsible. Therefore, you can, you know, influence things from the middle of the pyramid. It doesn't have to be at the base all the time, and it doesn't have to be at the apex all the time. So I think that if the idea has been put on the table, if they will not insist that, oh, if an idea comes from Atiku, they cannot take it, or they will take it only when it is clear and sitting them in the face that it was the best idea on the table, then I think they could consider it. Atiku has no power to force them, neither does he have any ability to compel them. What he can do is what you can do. Even you can come up with a paper and call it the suggestion for way forward. At least it shows that he's thinking about the problem. And if a man is thinking about the problem and is also articulating his position on it, he doesn't have to be 100% correct. No one individual has all knowledge. No one individual has know it all. That's why we are asking for this. Some of people are asking for this dialogue. And hopefully, even if we had a conference, don't forget that there are still routes it must go through. You still need these governors. It has to go through all the 36 centers of assemblies. That's how this thing works. That's how we structured it. So there's no, anyhow you flip it, these governors are critical to the peace, prosperity, safety, and unity of this country.
And finally, I want you to speak on the Nigeria is drifting quote. If you still believe, and if Atiku Abubakar still believes that Nigeria can be saved, action is taken, critical action is taken, or have we drifted too far off to be saved?
Well, when the Englishman says a stitch in time, you've heard it before, like yes. A stitch in time saves nine. The idea of a stitch in time saves nine is that time makes things better and time destroys things. If something is decaying and you don't quickly attend to it, there's going to come a time where, okay, is beyond being used and they throw it away. But if something is getting bad and you quickly get into it, do a surgical operation, remove the bad part, speak and all of that, then you can save it. That's precisely what this is all about. Is the country drifting? We cannot be in denial. It would be very ostrich-like to say, oh, we're not hearing all of this. Look, non-state actors are taking hold of the space. You have Boho in the southwest, you have iPod Man in the southeast, you have all sorts of characters, non-state actors, who are now beginning to hijack the emotions of the people and pushing them in all sorts of directions. Some of the agitations are legitimate, some of the means and ways they're going about it is totally unacceptable, but we still have governors, we have president, we have local government chairman. When you have the governors, you're as good as saying you have the local government chairman on board. And the governors are not, they're not so unschooled in management that they are not able to figure out what to do. And, you know, sometimes people get idea by inspiration. Perhaps now that Atiku has been inspired to put this out there, it's up to the governors who are in charge today to take it, or if they think it's not good enough for them, probably leave it. We're not going to say anything other than thank you, well done, we see you, we appreciate your effort for anybody that is talking.
Segun Shoumi, thank you so much for joining us on The Breakfast this morning. Interesting conversation. Looking forward to speaking with you again.
Yes, thank you.
All right, thank you, guys. Have a nice day.
You too, sir.
All right, so we'll take a break here. And next up, we're speaking with Ayuba Wabba, NLC president in Nigeria. He is the wanted man, as El-Rufai has declared him, in just a minute.